to Module 6, which is titled The Descent of Christ into Hell. We are going to go into some rather murky territory here, I admit, but where we are heading is where we've been really heading all along. In this course, we have been considering how God descends, condescends to us, how God lowers himself to us. Out of love, well, in this module, we're going to see where we've been heading all along, where Christ descends to hell, the utmost reaches of God's condescension, the descent of Christ into hell. Now, we don't have all of the details about this that we would like. It is in Scripture. It is certainly in the Apostles' Creed. It is one of the ancient doctrines of the church. We believe in the fact that Jesus descended into hell. But the other details, exactly what did he do there? What happened while he was there? How did he go about this journey through hell? We don't have everything there that we would like. We have the fact that we believe that he descended into hell, but we don't have all of the other details. And so the church has defined the fact that he descended, but it's left it to theologians to flesh out some of the details. There are very different schools of thought here that flesh out this biblical fact in more detail. Some folks agree with some aspects of it. We'll see all of that as this module unfolds. Okay, let's begin where all Christians begin. Let's look at the New Testament, and let's look at the biblical statements of Christ's descent into hell. It's not really mentioned in the canonical Gospels. There's this oblique reference to it at the end of Matthew's Gospel, when after the crucifixion, the rocks are split asunder, and then the saints come out of their tombs. So there's some reference there. It's an oblique reference, I admit. But to really see the details, we have to go to the Catholic epistles. And the two most significant passages for our matters here are in 1 Peter. So if we look at 1 Peter 3, verses 18 to 21, here's what it says. For Christ also suffered for sins once, the righteous, for the sake of the unrighteous, that he might lead you to God. Put to death in the flesh, he was brought to life in the spirit. In it he also went to preach to the spirits in prison, who had once been disobedient, while God patiently waited in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, in which a few persons, eight in all, were saved through water. Now, this is an admittedly difficult passage to interpret. I don't want to present to you the fact that I have all the answers. This passage has befuddled many biblical interpreters over the centuries. I will show you how the church tradition coalesced around this. But let's look at one more verse from 1 Peter. It will be in verse 6. For this is why the gospel was preached even to the dead, that though condemned in the flesh, in human estimation, they might live in the spirit in the estimation of God. These are the two key verses for us and for our consideration here. There are other references to the descent of Christ throughout the letters of St. Paul, scattered references, I have to be honest, in the letters of St. Paul, but it's in the book of Revelation that we have perhaps the most striking depiction in Revelation 1, verses 17 and 18, when Christ says that he is the first and the last and the living one, saying, "Further, I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and Hades." This image of the keys of Hades, we will see depicted a lot in later Christian art and iconography. So from these two selected citations from 1 Peter in particular, I want to focus on the themes that are contained within these two verses. From 1 Peter, we learn that Christ descended into hell, preaching to the souls of all those held there, not only to the righteous, but also to sinners. He was preaching to those who had also been disobedient during the time of Noah. So we have from that verse a theme of preaching. We also have Christ descending into Hades, conquering hell and death. We saw this in particular in Revelation. So also a theme of victory. Christ has the keys now of death and even of Hades itself. Okay, I've been using the word hell and Hades somewhat interchangeably, and they are used synonymously in the New Testament, but we have to be careful here. When we think of hell, we automatically think of a place of extreme punishment, a place of fire and brimstone, of fire in particular, but that's not what the ancients thought of when they thought of the word Hades. When the New Testament uses the word Hades and hell, they're going to mean something different from our ideas of hell. Time to bring a couple more distinctions to bear on this. Hades, of course, is a Greek word. It comes from the Greek god Hades, who's the brother of Zeus, and he governs the underworld, and so the place that he governs takes its name from his, and Hades is the name of the underworld for the ancient Greeks. The place Hades took its name from the Greek god Hades, and you can read all about Hades, at least as far as the ancient Greeks were concerned, in Homer's Iliad, and even more so in the Odyssey. These two epics, the Iliad and the Odyssey, were written down about 750 BC, and they basically describe Hades as a dark and dismal place. But it's not so much a place of fiery punishment. It's not exactly our hell yet, at least as we think of hell. Hades for them was more of a damp and moldy place where the souls of the departed went when they died. It was not originally, and not particularly, a place of fire and brimstone. Instead, it was more like a rather gray and colorless catch-all sort of place. For the Greeks, life up on Earth was exciting and adventuresome. Hades was more like, I don't know, an ancient Greek nursing home for the dearly departed. It's not a bad place, but certainly not a great place either. It's rather dull and routine in Hades, much like a nursing home is, I'm told. After the adventure and the thrill of life is over on Earth, for the ancient Greeks, they went to Hades. And this is probably what 1 Peter has in mind. Hades was a place more like this, not a place of punishment, but still no place that one really looked forward to going. When 1 Peter thinks of the souls of the good and the bad, and the unrighteous back in the days of Noah, now he's really thinking of the ancient world, he probably has them in Hades, the nursing home for the dead, rather than Hades, the lake of fire from the book of Revelation. Okay, we will see why in just a little bit. But right now I'd like to pivot from the ancient Greeks to the Old Testament. Hades for the ancient Greeks was very much like Sheol was for the Old Testament Jews. Much like for the ancient Greeks, the ancient Jews did not conceive of a hell like we do as this place of punishment and a place of fire. Really, our idea of hell is not in the Hebrew canon of Scripture. Those books are originally written in Hebrew, it's not there. It starts to appear somewhat tenuously in the later Greek Old Testament books. Those Old Testament books now, written not in Hebrew, but in Greek. You'll get these details later in your scripture class. Those Old Testament Greek books, written shortly before the time of Christ. There are a few oblique references there, but really, our idea of hell is not in the Hebrew canon. There might be one reference to Malachi, but in Malachi, I should say, but that's about it. Instead of our idea of hell, the ancient Jews had Sheol, which was, again, very similar to the ancient Greek Hades. Sheol, for the ancient Jews, was not a place of punishment. It certainly wasn't a place anyone really looked forward to going to after death, but it still was not a place of fiery punishment. Again, think of more of a celestial nursing home for souls after death, and you basically have Sheol. Sheol is mentioned over 65 times in the Old Testament. Again, it's not a place of punishment. It's just where everyone goes after death. Just a couple of examples. Again, there are over 65. But Psalm 139, verse 8, "If I climb to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there." So heaven and Sheol, two opposite extremes. The highest and the lowest places one can go, and still one cannot get away from God. But still, if one is able to make one's bed in Sheol, then it's definitely not a place of punishment. Maybe the best description of Old Testament Sheol comes from Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 10, which urges the reader to do anything and everything you can do now in life. Turn your hand to whatever you can do here and now. Ecclesiastes 9:10 says, because there will be no work, nor knowledge, nor reason, nor wisdom in Sheol where you are going. Do it now, Ecclesiastes 9:10 says. Live life now, enjoy life now, do what you can now, because you won't be able to do much of anything in Sheol. Like Hades for the ancient Greeks, Sheol was kind of like a nursing home today, I guess. It was more boring than terrifying. The joys of life were just not in Sheol, but neither was it a place of punishment. Sheol was just the place where everyone went after death, awaiting redemption. So usually the Hebrew word Sheol, when it's translated into our English Bibles, is usually translated as the netherworld or Hades. It's usually not translated as hell, because when we think of hell in English, we think of this place of fire and damnation and fire and brimstone. So when the English translations of the scripture are occurring today, normally they translate Old Testament Hebrew Sheol as, again, the netherworld, and not as hell, to make that distinction. Aren't these theological distinctions fun? I hope you're not entirely confused. I'll try to keep working at bringing clarity to this by making yet a few more distinctions. Usually when we think of hell, we think of a place of punishment, of fire, of torment, the place that is opposite of heaven, period. But again, as you can have started to have seen so far, the underworld for the ancients, including the people who wrote scripture, it wasn't just one place opposite heaven. In fact, the underworld had lots of levels to it. It was just not one place where everyone was lumped together. Instead, the underworld started to develop a very interesting geography to it. And as they say in the real estate business, it's all about location, location, location. Let's consider some of the different locations that made up the underworld for ancient minds, including the minds that wrote scripture. Okay, we have Sheol or Hades. I've kind of gone over that as this general holding pen for those who have recently died, but again, not necessarily a place of punishment. Over time, another term started to be used in theology called the Limbo of the Fathers. Who were the Fathers? And where were they in this Limbo of the Fathers? Well, the Limbo of the Fathers refers to all those Old Testament patriarchs and prophets from Adam and Eve all the way down through Moses, all those good and devout men and women, all those devout Jews who followed the law, but since they lived before the time of Christ, they didn't have the fullness of faith required to enter heaven. But since they were good people, neither did they deserve eternal damnation. This was the Limbo of the Fathers. The Fathers were all of those good and devout Old Testament personages that lived before Christ, awaiting the coming of the Messiah. And actually, some church fathers also put some of the classical authors there, like Virgil and Homer. There are some scattered references to the coming Messiah in the works of Virgil, in his eclogues. Again, because of this prediction of the coming Messiah, some church fathers put Virgil and Homer and some classical authors and lumped them in with the Limbo of the Fathers. And the word limbo here helps us to see that they were not damned. They were not punished. Sure, they could not see God and His fullness because they lived before Christ, but neither were they subjected to punishment. wasn't their fault that they lived before the time of Christ. So after their life on earth was finished, their souls went to the limbo of the fathers, the early Christians thought. With, again, the word limbo connoting a place in between heaven and Hades. Again, awaiting the arrival of Christ. That's the limbo of the fathers. Now, in Christian tradition, perhaps you are thinking of another limbo, the limbo of children. I was taught this in grade school, about the limbo of children. Let me clear this up right now. The limbo of children was never official Catholic doctrine. It was never defined Catholic doctrine. Now, it was in the Baltimore Catechism, to be sure. I was taught about the limbo of the children using the Baltimore Catechism. But the Baltimore Catechism is not official church doctrine. The Pope and ecumenical councils, or both of them together, are what define church doctrine. And church doctrine is defined by popes or councils or both. They are defining what's revealed in Scripture. That's where we get church doctrine. The limbo of children was never so defined. Never explicitly defined by either popes or councils. Now, it was in the writings of Augustine. You can find it in the writings of Thomas Aquinas, who both had enormous influence over the centuries. But neither of them decide church doctrine. Popes and councils together define and decide church doctrine. And besides Augustine and Aquinas, the reason this idea lasted so long was because it was a clear and easy answer to a very difficult question. If baptism is necessary for salvation, and we do believe it is, then what happens to unbaptized children? Where do they go? It's an honest question. And so to try to answer that question, Augustine comes up with this word limbo. Now, Augustine is trying his best to answer a very thorny question. If baptism is necessary for salvation, the unbaptized children can't go to heaven because baptism is required. But neither does it seem just for unbaptized children to go to hell. They've done nothing wrong. Augustine basically hedges his bets and dodges the question. He says they have to go somewhere. They must go someplace in between. I don't know, someplace called limbo, that he offers as a deliberate half-answer. Augustine doesn't know, but he's trying his best to answer the question. Augustine says they went to limbo. What he's really saying is, I basically have no idea just where they go. It's just someplace in between heaven and hell. It can't be either one of those places, and he left it at that. But because of Augustine's influence, and he was the greatest of the early church fathers, no doubt about that, but after Augustine, because of his influence, his "I don't know exactly where limbo is" turned into an actual exact location limbo, the limbo of children, which no matter how it was explained, was a source of some sorrow and anxiety for parents. It provided some but not very much comfort to parents. It made sense. It was clear. It was an easy answer to a difficult question. It was an answer that even children could understand. Where do unbaptized babies go? Well, they go to limbo, and then sister would be off to the very next question. It was an easy, clear answer, but it was just too easy. It was too clear. Which is why both Pope John Paul II and Pope Benedict XVI have recently written that it's time to let limbo go. It is time to let go of limbo, and Pope John Paul II allowed for a change in the new Catechism of the Catholic Church, which states that we can hope that God is powerful enough to draw all those who are not able to receive the sacrament of baptism to himself in heaven. If you'd like to read more about this, about the change in limbo that took place under both Pope John Paul II and Pope Benedict XVI, just Google "Closing the Doors of Limbo. Theologians say it was a hypothesis," and you see the link there. I'll also have that link for you in your external links tab inside your course on Blackbook. Okay, so much for Hades, Sheol, the the limbo of the fathers, and then now a discarded limbo of the children. There is, of course, a place in the New Testament that is a place of punishment and is a place of fire, Gehenna. It occurs and is placed on the lips of Jesus himself at least 10 times in the canonical Gospels. So Gehenna, obviously, is a place that has to be given the greatest importance and respect. What was Gehenna like? Well, Jesus compared Gehenna to the Valley of Hinnom. The Valley of Hinnom was a place of ancient evil, a place of idol worship, a place of pagan child sacrifice, and much, much worse before the Jews claimed Jerusalem. It was a valley outside the city of Jerusalem, and because of its ancient evil, the Jews turned the Valley of Hinnom into their garbage dump. It was the garbage dump for Jerusalem. It was always burning. It smelled horrible. It was a nasty place, to be sure, the Valley of Hinnom. Jesus compared Gehenna to the Valley of Hinnom so that his listeners would know exactly what he meant when he talked about Gehenna. Gehenna was a fiery, disgusting place where wickedness would be burnt up just like garbage is burnt up. Again, at least 10 times Gehenna is placed on the lips of Jesus, so that should be enough for us to take this seriously. Gehenna is certainly a place of punishment, a place of fire, a place unlike Hades or Sheol or the limbo of the fathers. Gehenna comes very close to our ideas of hell, but still not entirely so. In Luke's Gospel, in chapter 16, let's look at the story of the rich man and Lazarus. As we know there, when the rich man dies, he goes to the underworld. Now, if you look in the Greek text, in Luke's Gospel, he uses the word Hades. The word Hades is there, but it is also definitely a place of torment. So we can see how the development in this idea has occurred. Luke takes the word Hades from the ancient Greeks, he borrows it from them, but it's taken on added meanings. Now Hades is a place of torment, and it says so in verse 23. But still, it's not quite our hell, is it? Notice, the rich man can communicate with those in heaven. He converses with Abraham, which does not happen in our understanding of hell. For us, hell is entirely cut off from heaven. Notice also the rich man asks for some comfort, which at least to him seems possible, or he wouldn't have asked for it. It seems possible to him until he is told by Father Abraham that no, in fact, it is not possible, because an abyss has been fixed between the two locations. What's going on here? Well, in the ancient world, in the time of the New Testament, the underworld looked something like this. Hades could encompass paradise, the limbo of the fathers or Sheol, and Gehenna, the place of punishment. I'm going to call it hell after the resurrection, and I'll explain that later. Now, it seems very strange to us to have a place like paradise considered a part of Hades, even the upper part of Hades, but this was how the ancients conceived it. Now, this kind of structure would allow the rich man to talk to Abraham in Luke 16. If paradise is located in the upper part of Hades and Gehenna, the place of punishment, is in the lower part, still they're close enough that they can be in communication. It's also why the rich man thought that Abraham in paradise could send him some help, at least at first, until Abraham says that's not going to work. It also explains how Jesus could tell the good thief on the cross that this day you will be with me in paradise and still have Jesus descend into Hades if he arrives in paradise and yet continues his journey deeper into Hades. Okay, this was how the ancients conceived the underworld. So where do our ideas of hell, that place of utter punishment and fire and total separation from God, come from? Well, I will say to you, it's not because I know this, but based on a theologian you're going to meet very shortly, it was the resurrection that caused even the underworld to be rearranged. It was the resurrection of Christ that finally separated paradise from a place of punishment. It was the resurrection of Christ that is going to affect not just the apostles, not just those who ate and drank with him afterwards. The resurrection of Christ was an event of such significance that it even rearranged the cosmos. It even rearranged the underworld. It now made paradise completely separate from hell. Now there's a choice, you see, a definitive choice, either for or against Jesus Christ. The people in the Old Testament could not make that choice before his arrival. But now that he's here, now that he's come, now that his message has been proclaimed, now there is a choice. And it's a definitive choice, either for or against him. And because there is now a definitive choice, heaven has even been completely separated from hell. And this all occurs in the wake of the resurrection. I'm getting these ideas from a guy named Hans Urs von Balthasar. We're going to see him in just a little bit. We're going to meet him in more detail on the intensive weekend. But let me just now return to this theme of Christ's descent. We're going to see how the resurrection rearranged the underworld on the intensive weekend, but now I think we're in a position to take a closer look at what it meant for Christ to descend into hell. We know that he descends, but just where does he go? Did he go to the limbo of the fathers? Did he go down further, down to Gehenna? Where did Christ go when he makes his descent? Well, to begin to answer those questions, let's recap a little. Let's look back at the first letter of Peter, chapters 3 and 4. 1 Peter 3, 18 to 21 says that Jesus went to preach to those in prison, to the formerly disobedient. And we know from 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 6, that those condemned in the flesh in human estimation might live in the Spirit in the estimation of God. This was why Jesus went to preach to those in prison, according to 1 Peter. Scripture clearly says that Jesus went to preach to the formerly disobedient. This suggests that he went to preach to more than just the good, to more than just the Old Testament prophets and patriarchs who were awaiting the Messiah in the limbo of the fathers. But if Jesus went to preach to more than just the good Old Testament people, this suggests that he went to visit more than just the limbo of the fathers. It suggests he also visited the place of punishment, to a lower part of Hades, to Gehenna, where the disobedient were. The New Testament suggests that Jesus went to more than just to the limbo of the fathers, but that he also went deeper into Hades, down to where the disobedient were. Now, why preach to the disobedient? Again, 1 Peter 4, verse 6 suggests that it was to bring the disobedient, those condemned in the flesh, in human estimation, so that they might live in the Spirit of God. Now, wait a minute. Does that mean that the formerly damned were to be given a second chance? In the centuries after 1 Peter was written, more and more theological reflection was brought to bear on these admittedly difficult verses from the New Testament, especially by the great Saint Augustine, who clearly answered no, they could not. The damned were not to be given a second chance. They were not given a second chance in hell with the visitation of Christ. That would be unfair. Augustine thought that would just go against common sense for the disobedient to be given another chance at salvation after death. Okay, so then why go to preach to the disobedient, St. Augustine, if it was not to offer salvation? Well, Augustine's going to answer it was to shame them. It was to shame the disobedient. This is why Christ went to preach to the disobedient. It was to shame them, to double down, as the politicians say today, to double down on their damnation. I like the way that rolls off the tongue, by the way. To reinforce the fact that they were not saved and that they would never be saved. To conquer them, basically, and to reinforce their miserable plight. Now, why does Augustine think that Jesus would do such a thing, that Jesus would go down into hell to shame the disobedient? It basically is all a result of his theory of justification. It was his theology of predestination. Now, this theology of predestination, of the way God justifies and what God knows in this process of justification, this theology of predestination, there's a lot more to it than most people realize. It is a lot more nuanced than most people think when they hear this term. I'm going to have to leave it to our good Dr. Joshua Papsdorf to explain to you all the nuances of Augustine's theory of predestination. That will happen in a later class in Controversies in Church History. But very basically, according to Augustine's theory of predestination, since God knows who is going to be saved and who is not going to be saved, since he predestines, since he foresees all of this, he obviously knows who is going to end up rejecting his offer of salvation. And since he knows this, then why preach to the lost? Why preach to the damned? It would be a waste of time, to put it rather crudely, to say the least. St. Augustine did not believe that Jesus went to preach the good news of salvation to the formerly disobedient and hell, because there's really no point in doing that, according to his theory of predestination. But since Scripture does say that Jesus went there, what does Jesus do there? According to Augustine, his answer is, now you know, to shame them. That's why Jesus went down into Hades, to shame the disobedient. We see this motif a lot in Christian art, especially from the Middle Ages. Notice the demon squashed underneath the door. Jesus, quite literally, has kicked in the door of hell, catching a demon by surprise who ends up underneath it, squashed, vanquished, conquered. So for Augustine, three main points. Number one, when Christ descended, he only went to the limbo of the fathers. He only went to release the good, the Old Testament prophets and patriarchs who lived their faith, who awaited a Messiah, but who just lived before the time of Christ. He only went to release the Old Testament people who were good and awaiting the Messiah in the limbo of the fathers only. Number two, for Augustine, Jesus did not go any lower into Hades. He did not go into any place of punishment. He did not visit Gehenna. He did not go to preach good news to the disobedient. Why bother, Augustine thought? For Augustine, the disobedient did not so much listen to Christ when he arrives, but instead his arrival in Hades, into the limbo of the fathers, just hearing of his arrival was enough to shame them. Let me clarify that a little. So for Augustine, Jesus isn't actually preaching to the disobedient. Instead, Jesus, because the disobedient are in a place of punishment, instead, Jesus just goes to the limbo of the fathers, and word would have spread throughout all of Hades of his arrival, and just hearing of the arrival in Christ of Christ would have shamed them. They didn't actually hear his preaching, because for Augustine, why bother? Instead, Jesus' arrival into Hades was enough to shame them. So, number three, overall, Christ's descent was one of victory. Victory for the Old Testament prophets and patriarchs, and victory over the disobedient and the damned, especially the devil. Now, of course, Augustine's theory has a great logic to it. Of course, it's very intelligent, genius that he was, and of course, it's very sensible. But do you see how his development is at least one step removed from the text of the New Testament? Now, let me be clear. The damned are not given a second chance. The church has been very clear on this. It's in the catechism. The damned were not given a second chance. But I think it's a fair question. Were they truly damned before the time of Christ? And even if you want to answer yes, they were, let's hold on to that very important word from 1 Peter. Perhaps Jesus went to speak to the formerly disobedient who were not thereby damned. So maybe a distinction could be made there. Jesus went to preach to the disobedient, but not to the damned, if we want to hold all of these parameters and keep them in place. We're going to explore this much more on the intensive weekend. But let me say here that in my opinion, this is just my opinion now, the victory of Christ has been narrowed in the thinking of Augustine. The victory of Christ has been pared down. It's been pared down and narrowed from what we see in 1 Peter chapters 3 and 4. And it was Augustine's theory of predestination that caused this narrowing down of thought. Because Augustine's theory of predestination is going to be of such import, it's going to have such a huge impact upon the Western Church, both Catholic and eventually Protestant. Because his theory has such impact in the Church, it's going to impact all of the subsequent thinking on Christ's descent into hell. According to Augustine, Jesus no longer goes to preach good news to the disobedient so that they might live in the Spirit of God, to use the language of 1 Peter. Again, Augustine says, why bother? Why bother? There was no use. They had their chance and they blew it. Instead, for Augustine, Jesus goes to shame them. So again, out of this, the theory or the image of victory is going to dominate the church's understanding of Christ's descent into hell, especially after Augustine. Now, it was there before Augustine because it's in the text of the New Testament, but especially after Augustine, this image of the victory of Christ is going to take on more and more importance. Victory for the Old Testament prophets, victory over the disobedient and the damned. This theme of victory over Hades and death, which is in the New Testament, is going to take on a very militaristic interpretation long before Thomas Aquinas. But this militaristic interpretation of Christ's victory is going to become very pronounced in the early Dark Ages after the fall of Rome, through the High Middle Ages. We're going to see church fathers focusing on this one theme in particular of Christ's victory over Hades and the devil and hell. This is going to be known as Christus Victor in Latin, Christ the Victor. And so of all of the different themes in the New Testament on Christ's descent, this theme is going to be singled out and given a great prominence and a lot of development in the various theologians that come after the time of Christ. Christus Victor is what we call this theology, the theology of Christ the Victor, his victory over Satan, hell, and death. Here we see the idea of Christus Victor as painted by the masterful Fra Angelico. Here can be seen Christ literally kicking in the doors of hell. Again, an obvious demonstration of victory. Christ is basically storming hell with a demon caught by surprise, trampled underfoot as the door falls down on top of him. Christus Victor, this theology became very rich and very detailed over time. And it was really applied very creatively, and it answered a lot of questions, and it became a very rich theology, actually, that I'm quite fond of. So, for the question, how did Jesus overcome the devil? Christus Victor theology says, well, that Jesus basically tricked him. Where Christ served as bait, which the devil just could not resist. How does this work? Well, according to this take on Christus Victor theology, when the soul of Christ entered Hades, it was his human soul that the devil could not see as divine. The devil could not quite make out that this was the Son of God entering hell. The devil never thought that the Son of God would show up in hell. So, like any other soul, the devil tries to consume Christ, and instead of devouring just yet another soul, as he thinks, the devil, by devouring Christ, the Son of God, the devil himself is destroyed by this. By trying to destroy Christ, who was divine, the devil only ends up destroying himself. This idea of Christ as irresistible bait for the devil took many turns. Some fathers saw Christ on the cross as this bait. Others saw Christ journeying in Hades as this bait. There were various takes on it. I mean, here we can see the devil trying to consume Christ, but by doing so, the devil only manages to destroy himself. And there were lots of different ways of depicting this theology in Christian art over the centuries. But the main point was pretty much the same. By trying to destroy Christ, the devil himself was destroyed. They called these images hellmouth, and they were very prominent, especially in the English church. But they depict In one way or another, the devil trying to consume Christ, but in the process, he himself is destroyed by this. The devil thinks he is winning by taking Christ's life, but just the opposite happened. In taking Christ's life, death and the devil are both defeated. It looks like he's winning by taking Christ's life. Instead, it's the devil who loses. That's Christus Victor theology in a nutshell. And this theology was used recently to great effect in a Hollywood movie called Gran Torino. This was a movie by Clint Eastwood. In fact, Clint Eastwood is the star, and I will argue that Clint Eastwood is a Christ figure in this movie, and that Clint Eastwood shows us this Christus Victor theology in just remarkable detail. And yes, you heard me right. Clint Eastwood as a Christ figure, it's pretty obvious when you see this video clip. Okay, let's look at this now, and let's just take this clip in, and I'll point out, if you miss some details, I'll clear it up after you watch this video.
I didn't think your ass would have came.
Shut up, Goop. I got nothing to say to you. Midget like you. Yeah. You go ahead. Watch out for your boyfriend. Because it was either he or you or someone who raped one of their own family. Your own blood, for Christ's sake. Now go ahead and pull those pistols like miniature cowboys. Go ahead.
So where's Tao at?
Don't worry about Tao. Tao's got not 1 second for you.
Seth Hope. Yeah.
Yep. Fuck that. Old man.
What you gonna do, man?
Kinda jumpy, aren't we?
Shut
You shut the light. No. Me. I've got a light. Hail Mary, full of grace.
Did you catch all of those Christus Victor details in that little clip? Let me point out a couple, just to make sure you get the point here. Just like Christ entering into darkness, Clint enters into a very dark place at the beginning of this video clip. And just like Christ, Clint was up against some very horrible, almost demonic forces. At least they're sure demonic characters in this little clip from this movie. And just like Christ, did you notice Clint won't let the gangsters speak to him? He tells them to shut up. Notice how many times in the Gospels Christ won't let the demons speak. Neither does Clint in this little movie clip. Now you have to watch the whole movie to get this, but what Clint is basically trying to do is he's trying to save this young friend of his who's being threatened by these thugs. And Clint has cancer, he knows he's dying. And so he's bound and determined to do whatever he can to help his young friend escape these gangsters. And the only way that Clint can be sure that his young friend will escape the clutches of these horrible people is for Clint to make sure they go to jail. And so how does he make sure they go to jail? Well, he tricks them. He tricks them into shooting him. He tricks them into shooting him in front of all of those eyewitnesses. So that is how Clint can guarantee that these guys will end up in jail, and he can guarantee that his young friend will be safe. Clint goes into this wanting to be the bait. That's Christus Victor, theology in spades. And did you even notice how he dies at the end after he's shot? After those guys take the bait and they shoot him, Clint dies in that crucifixion posture. I mean, it's pretty obvious there, I would think. And again, he dies by reciting the Hail Mary. Obviously, there are religious overtones that the movie is trying to suggest. What I'm suggesting is even more than just religious. It's a very specific form of theology. It's Christus Victor theology on display. Rarely does Hollywood get it so right. Rarely does it use theology to such great effect. Okay, so now I think you have a pretty good idea of what Christus Victor theology is all about and how some church fathers understood the descent of Christ into hell, that he basically went there serving as bait for the devil, that he went in to storm Hades, that he goes to release the good and to shame the bad, at least as far as some people think. But let's think about this Christus Victor theology just a little bit more. Now, yes, the New Testament does contain the idea of victory. That's clearly there. And so it's not that this is all wrong or that it's all that. But still, is this really how Christ would do it? Is this really how Christ would act? We all believe Christ was victorious over death. But was this how he did it? Basically acting like some kind of spiritual Rambo, kicking in the doors of hell and just releasing the good and shaming the bad? Was he basically a Clint Eastwood figure, just, you know, storming into hell and freeing the good and shaming the bad? I don't think so. Is this the way God pursues us? Is this the way God condescends? Is this the way that God seeks us out? Is this the way that God lowers himself? As we've been considering throughout this class, I think you know my answer would be no. Now, this is just my opinion. I like the Christus Victor theology as much as any other red-blooded American male. I mean, it's got a definite appeal to it. But it's not about appealing to our cultural norms today. It's trying to determine the person of Christ. How would Christ act? How would Christ descend? I would suggest to you that the Christus Victor theology owes much more to the militaristic context of the ages in which this Christian thought was developed. There was always a war going on somewhere back then. And of course, during the Crusades, it would have obvious appeal. But if Christus Victor theology is referencing more the culture than it is the person of Christ, well, then I think it can be revised. And there is somebody who tried to do this. Now, again, this is only my personal opinion. The church has not determined exactly how this all happened and exactly what happened when Christ descended. We believe that he descended into hell, since that's in Scripture. But just what happened there, very few things about this have been defined by the church. There are a couple other parameters that we're going to look at about this issue when we come together on the weekend. But my point here is we're not tied to any one explanation or any one theory. We're not tied to the Christus Victor approach. There are others who have come up with different theories, different theologies, I should say, of Christ's descent. Might there be another way of conceiving how Christ descended into hell? Yes, there is one, and it was generated by a magnificent theologian by the name of Hans Urs von Balthasar. Hans Urs von Balthasar was a Catholic priest, though like most German professors, he didn't wear the Roman collar when he was teaching. Von Balthasar died in 1988, and I would say that since Vatican II, the thought of Karl Rahner has declined, and the work of von Balthasar has only gained in importance. Rahner was very important in the 60s, and especially at Vatican II, but since Vatican II, Rahner seems to have been on the decline, and Hans Urs von Balthasar seems to have vaulted over him and to have claimed the place as the most, arguably, important Catholic theologian of the late 20th and I would say early 21st century. Although a case could be made now for a certain Joseph Ratzinger, who went on to become Pope Benedict XVI. But still, I think Rahner has declined, whereas Balthasar right now is certainly one of the most, if not the most, important Catholic theologian. Now, Balthasar's theology is very long and complex and highly nuanced. It's very rich. It's very dramatic. It's considered, some of it is considered somewhat controversial. In fact, I think probably his theology of the descent of Christ into hell is probably among the most controversial aspects of his writings. But let me say to you this. Hans Urs von Balthasar was the favorite theologian of Pope John Paul II. Pope John Paul II wanted to make him a cardinal. He died before he could receive that honor, so we don't refer to him as Cardinal von Balthasar today. But certainly he was JP2's favorite theologian, and if he was good enough for JP2, well, then he's good enough for me. Still, there are some people who are a little nervous about von Balthasar's theology of Christ's descent into hell. There are a lot of folks who admire much of what Balthasar did, but are still a little, nervous or not quite so convinced about his theology of the descent. It's way too complicated for us to discuss it here. I'm saving it for the intensive weekend. We're going to dive into the theology of Hans Urs von Balthasar with his focus on Christ's descent into hell on the intensive weekend. So I look forward to seeing you very soon on the intensive weekend and leading you into the thought of Hans Urs von Balthasar on the descent of Christ into hell. There are no threaded discussions over this module since we're getting together very soon. There is a reading assignment on the syllabus, and if you can read that before we get together, it would be helpful. I know time's a little tight right now. It's not entirely required for you to get the most out of the weekend. You can catch up on that reading assignment after the weekend, certainly. But if you have a chance, it would be great to do the reading assignment before we get together Friday night on the intensive weekend. Thank you very much for your attention on this module. I look forward to seeing you very soon, and until then, goodbye.